नमः शिवाय स्टूडेंट्स, यू हैव ऑलरेडी लर्न्ड द ग्रेट एपिक महाभारता इन क्लास 6, 7 एंड 8. इन क्लास 10 यू विल लर्न एन अब्रिज वर्जन ऑफ द गीता विच इज द पार्ट ऑफ महाभारता. भगवता गीतम इति भगवद गीता, अ सॉन्ग सांग बाय लॉर्ड कृष्णा. इट इज द एसेंस ऑफ वेदा. इट इज अ टॉर्च लाइट फॉर द होल ऑफ ह्यूमैनिटी. इट रिवील्स and prompts the individuals in the execution of their exact duties. In the words of Adi Shankaracharya, from a clear knowledge of the Bhagavad Gita, all the goals of human existence become fulfilled. Bhagavad Gita is the manifest quintessence of all the teaching of the Vedic scriptures. The Bhagavad Gita is composed of 700 Sanskrit verses contained within 18 chapters, divided into 3 sections, each consisting of 6 chapters. They are Karma Yoga, the Yoga of Action, Bhakti Yoga, the Yoga of Devotion, and Jnana Yoga, the Yoga of Knowledge. Students, you know, the practical aspect of this book helps us in our day-to-day life and suggests an easy, adaptable way to conquer our inner darkness and attain the Supreme Being. Let's start with Chapter 1, that is Arjuna Vishada Yoga, the Yoga of Arjuna's Dejection. The blind king Dhritarashtra, fond father to his 100 criminal-minded children, was anxious. A strange anxiety filled his clouded mind and he felt a painful stab of conscience. In this tremendous war, his children and their powerful followers were arrayed on one side. The lesser forces of his brother's children, advised by Krishna, the Yadava, were arrayed on the other. Even with this unequal distribution, would his progeny escape destruction? Thoughts tormented him and he wrung his hands in despair. His son, Prince Duryodhana, should be the king of the great kingdom of Hastinapura by right. If only the Pandavas had agreed to it, there would have been no reason for this chaotic war. Bitterness welled up inside him. He turned to Sanjaya, his faithful charioteer. As he spoke, his words unintentionally betrayed his loyalties aloud. In the holy land of Kurukshetra, where they have assembled to war against each other, what are my sons and those of Pandu doing, Sanjaya? With these words, the Bhagavad Gita commences. Sanjaya, who has been given the gift of divine vision, supernatural viewing capacity by Sage Vyasa, gives us a live commentary on the war. The Gita is revealed to us chapter by chapter through the words of Sanjaya, who, in spite of being the king's trusted aide, is a follower of Dharma and is hence the best commentator possible. In response to the king's question, Sanjaya trains his enhanced vision and audio faculties on the battlefield and speaks. Sanjaya, knowing the king's mind, first narrows in on his master's beloved son, Prince Duryodhana. At that time, Duryodhana is engaged in a self-convincing act. Having scrutinized the two armies standing face to face, and having assessed his own army to be larger, Duryodhana is still not convinced about their superior might. His self-confidence is ebbing away and he seeks out Acharya Drona, their teacher in the art of combat, for reassurance. The Kauravas' lifelong aggression against the Pandavas has culminated in this war. But even with all the odds pointing his way, like a greater army might, support of the elders and support of mighty neighbors, the leader of the Kurus remains unsettled. You know, students, when we know in the heart of our hearts that our motives are impure and unjust, we would necessarily feel the way Duryodhana did, agitated and restless. In his anxiety, Duryodhana is in a mode of hyperactivity. His blabbering speech reveals his internal fear, and as though reassuring himself of his victory in this war, he begins to point out the great warriors in his camp to Acharya Drona. Veteran of several wars and a keen observer, Acharya Drona easily recognizes the mental state of his least liked pupil and remains scornfully silent. Knowing that Duryodhana's foolish blabbering will have serious repercussions, Bhishma, the grandsire in the epic, seeks to put a stop to it. He picks up his conch and blows into it. The mighty sound tears through the battlefield, inviting responses from both sides, raising a battle roar, making both heaven and earth reverberate. Thus starts the Kurukshetra War. It is at this imminent moment and the start of the combat that Arjuna chooses to enter the battlefield. Arjuna is described here as a man who is ready to fight. He has his trusty bow Gandiva poised. He shows a strong command to his charioteer, none other than Lord Krishna, to position his chariot in a place where it is easy to observe both armies, so that he might identify his adversaries. He behaves as any courageous soldier would, seeking to assess his combat position and map his strategy. Lord Krishna flicks the reins of his four horses and draws up the chariot in a place facing the two armies and addresses his best friend and companion of many years, Arjuna. "Parth," he says, "behold the forces of the Kauravas." When Lord Krishna stations the chariot in a place where Arjuna can see all his kinsmen and arrayed to fight against him and addresses Arjuna thus, he completely understands its consequences. He anticipates the confusion in Arjuna's mind and secretly enjoys it. In fact, here is the teaching moment the guru in him has been waiting for. Upon seeing his friends, elders and loved ones in the enemy camp, Arjuna stands for a moment as though thunderstruck. His trusty Gandiva bow falls from his shaking hands. In his own words, "My limbs fail, my mouth is dry, my body shivers, my hair stands on end, my skin burns all over and my head whirls around." Gone from the warrior is all his soldierly strength of mind and courage to face any adverse situation. In the shock of the moment, he collapses into a survival mode, the flight instinct. He makes up one excuse after another, so he will not have to fight. "What good can come of killing one's king?" he says. "Perhaps I should just retire into the forest to spend the rest of my days in renunciation." His first excuse is delivered to a silent Krishna. "I do not desire victory," he cries. "I have never desired it at the extinction of this dear and near." Do you know, students? Arjuna has clearly desired victory. But now, seeing the vast enemy army and its capacities, he becomes uncertain what he wants. This is why he is lining up his excuses before the Lord. "What shall we gain by killing these sons of Dhritarashtra?" he says. "For sure, sin alone shall be our lot." Lord Krishna again is silent. Arjuna is like a mental patient now, and Lord Krishna acts as his personal psychologist, letting him exhaust himself with his talk. "If our deluded cousins are set upon doing evil, should we also retaliate in the same language? Isn't our duty, our dharmic duty, to forgive their transgression?" retire quietly and suffer the indignity of defeat? Arjuna argues again. Finally, he declares, it would be better if the Kauravas were to riddle me with weapons and kill me while I stand thus, unarmed and unresisting. He sits down in his chariot, casting off his weapons, dejected and grief-stricken. You know, students, this chapter of the Bhagavad Gita is very thought-provoking. Arjuna's eloquent words and convincing arguments seems entirely logical to our mind. These are the very arguments our minds present to us when we are confronted with a, you know, pressing situation. The Gita is Lord Krishna's advice on how to confront problems in our life. In the ensuing chapter, we learn what is dharma and what is adharma, and what we should do to achieve the success we desire. In fact, the Bhagavad Gita is the cosmic survival guide of how to face problems and surmount obstacles in order to lead a successful life. Today up to this. In the next video, we will learn chapter 2 of Bhagavad Gita. Namah Shivaya.